Okay. First of all, I want to show you how to download the form. You go to the FDOT website, you probably Google FDOT forms, and then you come to this particular website, and you go to the standard operations system, go to forms. And if you search them by title, and type the word anchor, you should be able to get the form in here. So I normally go there to search for the keyword anchor, and then there's only one choice it will give it to you. So you can download the form from here. Okay, the general setup of the form, there are five main tabs when you open up that download file. The general setup instruction, calibration input, proof template, performance template, and quick template. That's the five tabs you will have when you in the downloaded version. Okay, so I will start out talking about the calibration input tab first. Okay. According to 451 specifications, the contractor will submit to the engineer the calibration of their pressure gauge and their load cell before the testing. Okay, so what do you do with this data? You input into this calibration setup input tab in here. And what is the purpose? The purpose is that when during the test, when you look at the pressure gauge, when it reads a certain PSI, or when the load cell show you a certain reading, this reading is actually can be correlated to a certain load. So with this number, you know that the test is following the test schedule. You know that your acceptance criteria has been met because you are asked to load the anchors to the design load at the end. So that is the purpose of this particular tab, okay? And all the cutter cells in here has to be input. The way that this graph or calibration works is this. We are doing this with linear interpolation. Supposedly, you know, for example, when we input the pressure gauge reading of, let's say, 1500 PSI, what the computer will do is that it will come up here on the line and then will read off the coordinate of the graph and calculate the load for you. But they're only looking at the two adjacent points only. So that is important, and each of these calibration allows you 10 coordinates for the calibration. Okay, you can input less than 10 coordinates if needed. If you don't need all 10 calibration, more than 10 points is fine. But the main issue is this: the maximum load in each of these anchors have to be greater than the design load of your anchor. For example, your anchor may have an capacity of 100 kips. So all the calibration load, hopefully the test that you have, the calibration result from the laboratory give you more than 100 kips, obviously they should be, okay? But you make sure that if you're not inputting all the lines, make sure that you exceed 100 kips and hopefully with a little margin. Likewise, for the pressure gauge PSI reading, if in case you get it too marginal, let's say exactly 100 kips at 5,000 PSI, for example, you may want to increase it to 6,000 PSI as well, because in the field, you may be reading 5,100 PSI, and if that is the case, you know, because of how the algorithm works, you have to exceed the maximum pressure gauge reading that you have. The computer is going to make calculation errors if you don't do that. Down here, the spreadsheet will plot the graph for you. One of the main purposes for it for this is in case you have a typo error. For example, 119, oops, okay. In case you have a typo error, this will, the graph will show it to you. like that. So you will realize that, okay, this doesn't look resembling like a straight line. So something must be wrong. Let me double check the readings. Mm-hmm. I'm going to start out to talk about the proof test. In general, there are three types of tests according to 451 specifications. They are proof test, performance test, and crit test. And each one of these has a template in here. Okay? And the main thing is that at the end of the day, each anchor will be tested before they accept it. So each anchor that you have really should have a tab of its own. And based on the anticipated test you think is going to happen on this test, you create a copy from this template. And for those who are not familiar enough with the Excel, you basically right click and you go to move or copy and you say create a copy and you're okay. Then they will create a tab for you. So you can just double click it and you can call it anchor number one. And that is your anchor number one record. And you can start working with this record for your anchor number one. And how you organize your spreadsheet is all up to you. They're flexible. At the end of the day, you want to provide records of every anchor. And there may be reasons that you may end up with more than one workbook per wall, because the contractor may have done two calibrations. They finished some anchors. They stop and then they recalibrate the equipment, the pressure gauge and load cell, and they restart it. And of course, you may have to do that. As long as your file names help you document these are anchors 1 through 10 and the other one 20 through 30, whatever, to explain the situation so that whoever wants to, they can figure it out. And the templates are color-coded on the tab, so that at a glance, hopefully you will see the green color is the proof test, the pink is the performance, and the blue is the crit. So at a glance, you will know which one is the performance test and which one is the crit test accordingly. Okay, the top of these of the three spreadsheets are practically identical at the top portion. Okay. So, and there are common information like project name and project number that obviously should not change within your project, and any other information. If you have only one wall, you put down the wall number as well. And before you make copies, that will save you time to when you create those copies. So not retyping, those same information over and over again. Again, all the yellow cells here are the input fields. For example, I want to show that there are also help and guidelines to help you. For example, when you move the mouth and touch this area of a strand or bar per square inch, it will give you the ASHTO or ASTM standards that I find currently. To help you. For example, when you have on this example a 270 grade 270 steel with 0.6 inch diameter strand, the area should be 0.217 according to the ASHTO. So that will help you in calculating that or finding that area, because the area is going to be doing the calculation. This spreadsheet will do a lot of calculations. They will do the grabbing for you. The wrong input will give you the wrong calculations, obviously. Okay, but you can also you should also refer to your mule test report for the information like that. Another cell, for example, is the again refer to the mule test report for the actual elastic modulus of your tendon, either the bar or the strands. Okay, for steel bar, the literature is telling me that it's fairly constant, 30 times 10 to the power 6 psi. For steel strands, they vary because these are branded strands and they do vary. So they do vary from 28.5 to 30. Okay, so in case you do not have the information, my recommendation for you is to use the lower value. It will give you more conservative results. However, if you fail marginally, then you should go back to the mu test report. Maybe it is close to 29, who knows, for the batch that you have used. One of the things I want to talk about next is the what we call the pressure control pressure gauge input cell right here. Okay, this particular input is important because it, as I have said, the specification tells you that you have a pressure gauge and you have a reference gauge, and you input two calibration in there. And this number, you have to input either one or two into this cell. The reason is that once you put a one or two, then basically it will go back to this calibration graph. If you type one, then your calibration number one will become your pressure gauge. And the other one by default will become the reference gauge. And the significance is that the pressure gauge is always used to calculate acceptance criteria. The reference gauge there is only as a check. Okay, so that's the difference. If they are different, the pressure gauge will control the acceptance. And after you finish the installation of the anchor, I would expect it would be something like this at that time. So the only missing information there would be the jack length. And this is just to illustrate to those who are not familiar enough with what is a jack length. It's basically the length of the tendon that is above the unbonded length to where the, in this case, the bar is locked off to the tendon at some point in here. And this length will still be extended during the test. Okay? And this is accounted for one of the acceptance criteria. So this is the jack length when you're using a bar. And when you input, when you have selected your calibration gauges, in this case number two as a reference gauge, the computer here will automatically establish some targets for you. Okay, and this is again based on that calibration inputs that I've been talking about. And I would expect the inspector to record all the information in the yellow cells here. If in case your actual pressure is greater or equal to the target, they will actually show you as if in black color. But in this example, if your number is actually lower, then it will show as red. It's just a flag for the inspector out in the field while they are doing it, is it above the target or not. Another feature that we have added in here is that this form is set up such that we have a timetable and schedule, everything laid out as a form according to the specifications. For the proof test, this is the loading schedule, and when they reach the design load, they have to wait either 10 or 60 minutes. So the form is set up that way. So if you do have to do that, you would want to set up your timetable of taking readings. For example, if I put in 2:22 a.m. here, then it will actually give me the time when I should be taking the reading. So it's a tool to help you doing your job out in the field, because we're expecting these forms to be used in the field eventually. The dotted line here is just a reminder. In proof and performance tests, the test may terminate at 10 minutes. If the, according to the specifications, if the movement of the dial gauge between 1 and 10 minutes is less than 0.04 inch, then you actually have accepted, it has passed one of the criteria. So this is the dotted line to remind the inspector that, hey, maybe we can stop the test here, just take a look at it. However, if it is greater than 0.04, then you have to continue performing the test, taking the readings until it is 60 minutes. So this dotted line is there just to, as a reminder. Lift-off test. These are pre-stressed saw anchors. So after you install the anchors, there will be a pre-stressed force inside the anchors. Okay. So, and this lift-off test is there to double check that whether the pre-stressed force is right or wrong. So and they will perform a lift-off test, and this is the pressure gauge readings that you will be getting or recording to calculate whether it has satisfied the specification requirement or not. According to the specifications, it has to be within 10% of what is intended. And this is the actual intended lock of the pre-stress force. In this case, 76.8 kips. Performance tests. Basically, what we have talked about in proof test template, they're identical in performance template for the ease of it. One of the main difference is that in performance and creep test, you always have to use this reference gauge. And so you have an extra field for input in the performance tab and creep test tab as well. According to the specifications, the pressure gauge and the reference gauge has to be within 10%. The lows that they calculate at the end, they have to be within 10%. And there are calculations available. The spreadsheet will actually calculate the percentage difference at every single entry for you between the pressure gauge and the reference gauge on the side in here. And I'll show you some examples later on. Acceptance criteria. Every tab is also established with the acceptance criteria. For example, this is a proof test form, and you can see that that there are three lines there. The first one is anchor elongation less than 0.04 inch between 1 and 10 minutes. That is the criteria that I was talking about. If it passed the criteria, it will automatically give you a yes. Okay. And the second one is the criteria that applies to all the anchors. There's a minimum elongation in all the anchor tests that they must exceed. And actually, they are calculated always in here, down here. In this case, it's 1.232 inches. And if you look at this particular example at the end, they were at 2.35 inch. So they exceed the criteria, so they did pass the criteria.
Where does the criteria come from?
Oh, it's in the specifications. There's a minimum elongation, basically requiring that you have to, the maximum readings that you are getting from the elongation needs to be at least 80% of the jack length plus 80% of the unbonded length. Okay? Because that part is not grouted, so there's no reason why it should not be the tenon should not extend according to the elastic theory. But and in case it is not, that also may mean that the grout has now get into the unbonded length, which is not allowed. We cannot derive our capacity from the unbonded length of the anchor. Okay, and in this example, where if you have to run the test up to 60 minutes, then it will also give you a criteria whether at between 6 to 60 minutes it exceeds the 0.08 inch per lock cycle of time criteria according to the specification. So looking at this, you will be able to, at a glimpse, you will see what the computer thinks about the acceptance criteria, whether they are met or not. These forms are also, they all have this particular graph, which is the dial gauge reading versus the actual load. This is just a visual aid to help us to figure out what is happening. is there seems to be some major error or typo error. Sometimes I do notice some major typos errors in here. For the performance tests, because we are doing the loading, we are doing loading and unloading cycles in performance tests and crypt tests. And we also have what we call the load holding period, that we keep the load and then maintain the pressure and take the readings. So those are the main difference in terms of the loading schedule of a performance test. And because we do that, we can also do a few more calculations of the same graph in here, and they will do it automatically for you. Okay, and these are mostly for the engineer to assess your test result. If it, like, let's say if they pass or if they fail, you know, how does it look? It is for engineering assessment. For the crypt test log, they also the form also have the same graph, and on top of that, they also show you all the readings during the load holding periods of the other load. So again, these are for graphic display of the information. Caution messages. The spreadsheets are coded such that if they anticipate, if you input something is totally unexpected, it will give you some errors. Error message in here. In this particular example, as I have said before, this control pressure gauge calibration number needs to be a 1 or 2. If you input anything other than 1 and 2, it will give you an error message. It may still doing some calculation, making some assumptions, but the fact is that it needs to be a 1 or 2, and if it is not, you need to know, because the spreadsheet may not be doing the calculation like what you think it should be. And for a crypt test, a low cell is always needed. So if you input in the cell in here, low cell use is no. In a crypt test form, they will also give you a reminder. A low cell is required for crypt test, basically, to remind you that, yes, you do need the low cell. And in this case, let me get this down a little bit. An error message will pop up if the design load, which is the maximum load the anchor will be tested to, exceed the calibration graph input data that you have made previously. You know, in this particular case, we have only up to 149 kips in one of the anchor and 265 and 360 kips accordingly. But I purposely typed the number 1000 here, and it will tell you that, hey, your calibration, you need more calibration data in here. It is not doing the calculation like what you think it is going to do. Lift-off tests, the same way. If the lift-off test, well, in this case, the lift-off target reading is 2510 PSI, and the actual that it was recorded was 3000. So the spreadsheet will calculate for you and tell you that, hey, your actual lift-off low is 92.23 kips, and you should be actually 76.8, and you are exceeding 10% tolerance. So it's, you know, the contractor would, in that case, they need to disassemble and readjust their chuck and their nuts and so on to get the right pre-stress force. And in case, and as I have indicated previously, the pressure gauge and the low cells are, well, and the reference gauge has to be within 10% of the comparison. So in this case, I just changed one reading, you know, purposely from 3400 to 5000 just to illustrate the point. If you go to the side, you will see that instead of a load of 107 kips, it actually record now calculated as 149 kips. So the error between the pressure gauge and the reference gauge is now 27% at 0.8 design low. All these blue cells here on the right side are correlated to the 80% design load. Okay, so if any of those cells exceed 10%, then that means they're exceeding the specification requirement. And because of that, the spreadsheet at the bottom will also tell you the same thing. Hey, you have a, it is more than 10% tolerance. It is beyond that down here according to the specification. These are tools to help you that during the test you will realize that there might be an issue and the contractor may have to do something to fix it. So the last thing I want to talk about is about what is described here in the general setup instruction. All these spreadsheets, when you create copies of these templates into an anchor, they will always be looking for the calibration input tab of the same spreadsheet, always, okay? So if in case you have two workbooks, you have called this workbook number one, and then you have another workbook called workbook number two. You want, for some reason, you want to merge the data into one workbook. You cannot just copy the anchor number 10 from the workbook number two into this workbook, because they will always be looking for the calibration input of workbook number two. So the only way to bypass it is to change the name of workbook number two, something like calibration input two, and then you move both anchor number 10 records and the calibration input two into this spreadsheet. That's the only way you can merge it together. Okay, but in order to avoid the confusion, because sometimes this is needed when the contractor recalibrate exact same equipment. So how do you make the distinction between the two? So in my suggestion would be that on the description of the calibration input, you will also type in, say, a recalibrated a certain date, let's say January 1st, 2018, to make that distinction so that you don't confuse the reviewers later on. Even though it's doing the calculation right, but they were scratching their head and they couldn't figure out why things doesn't make sense in here. So that's the only way that we can organize the file and still make it function as it intends. So that's all that I have prepared. Any question? Okay. If not, I pass the phone to Juan.
Thank you, Wayne.
Oh, okay.
There's a question.
Is your example spreadsheet up here going to be available for us to review, like being put on the SharePoint or something?
I can put it there.
What was the question again?
He was wondering whether I can put this spreadsheet on the SharePoint eventually. Kind of.
Okay.
Yeah.
Oh.
Right.
No. Okay. Yes, we.
Right.
We could do that.
Yes.
No problem.
Thank you.
Sure.
I'll just add one comment, Wayne. Most of your contractors who do this kind of work, they've got their own sheets that are similar to this, so they're also doing what you're doing. So if you go to communicate with them so that if you had a difference in opinion on what the load should be, you can start out in the field.
Right.
Yeah.
Let me elaborate this.
Yeah, the question of Roger was that his comment was that most of the contractor has their own sheets, their own forms, and so we need to communicate with them. I'd like to make a comment. We have put as a requirement in the specs beginning January 2018 that this form is the official one. It's in the specs. So, and what I have seen through the reviews is, the form that I have seen from contractors out there are pretty much what Wing is putting here.
Mm-hmm.
So, go ahead, Wing.
Right. Yes. The contractor, some contractors, they are using similar methods and so on, and they will look similar. But the way they calculate their target is a little bit different. They will input all the data and get a regression line through all the data points and give you one equation. Actually, I calculate the equations in here on the spreadsheet as well. Okay, actually, I was intending to use this equation at the very beginning of the development. And then I realized something that some calibration that I have seen, the load are not lining up perfectly in the good straight line in much higher load. When, let's say, my anchors go up to 100 kips, and they calibrate it to 3,000 kips, maybe 300 kips, excuse me, that's what I meant. So between the 200 and 300 kips, I found out that some of the data are not lining up well. So if I ignore those data above the 100 kips, the equation actually changed. So that's why I was coding it according to the linear interpolation, like what I've said before, to avoid that problem. Because at some point in time, you know, my equation, I have to decide how many points to set up, the equation may change accordingly as well. And a lot of times I have seen those calibration that these companies do, they would do it three times anyway. So every, for instance, they would do it at 100 PSI, they would load it up gradually, they would take the readings of the load that they measure three times in three different cycles, and they would take average of them. So if you do it three times and take average, and they are reasonably close to each other three times, so I thought that was close enough to use the method that we have been using. And like what Juan said, it will eventually be required for the contractor to use this form. The contractor is required to submit to you, to the engineer, at the end of the job, the mill test report and all the test results. Okay. So right now, the specification does not require them to use this form, and I fully understand why. They don't even have a form, and this specification has been there around more than 30 years, I'm guessing. But eventually, the new spec will require them to use this form.
Thank you, Wing. Great job. Good presentation. I like it. Tell you what,